right, everyone, we're back here with another video about the duties and responsibilities of a clinical pharmacist. Now, if you're new to my channel, this is the part two of a series of videos talking about clinical pharmacy, specifically duties and responsibilities of a clinical pharmacist at a hospital or a clinic or even in the community in North America. Mainly because that's where I practice, but again, you can take these and apply to wherever you work, whichever country you work at. It's pretty much similar at any country or any place you work. Now, if you're new to my channel, make sure to subscribe to the channel so that you get notifications about future videos. I teach clinical pharmacy online for free on my channel, and I also have my clinical pharmacist book if you're interested in purchasing that. But all the videos here are free, and it will help you advance your career and learn all about clinical pharmacy for free on the channel. Now let's get started with part two of this video that we stopped at point number four now, of the duties and responsibilities of a clinical pharmacist, which is basically assisting the healthcare team in developing a drug therapy guideline for individual disease conditions by reviewing the current literature, compiling and analyzing information relating to current therapy guidelines, providing suggestions and recommendations, and monitoring the effectiveness of current guidelines on patient healthcare outcomes. Of course, this is something that a clinical pharmacist needs to know how to do. However, not every clinical pharmacist does that. Let me explain further. In some cases, you will find yourself part of a team that your job, or part of your job, is to develop such a guideline to prevent diseases or to optimize therapy. An example of that is the antimicrobial stewardship program. I don't know if you heard about that before, but you might see me or hear me talking about that a lot on my channel. So in hospitals, there are usually antimicrobial stewardship programs to optimize the use of antibiotics. And almost each hospital or health authority has its own antimicrobial stewardship program, which is a program that promotes optimal antimicrobial therapy within that hospital or within that health authority. I'll definitely talk more in depth about that in future videos. However, this program, and right now what I want you to know is that this program is usually created by a team of infectious diseases doctors and also pharmacists specialized in infectious diseases. So if you have an infectious diseases specialty from the United States, for example, or you've practiced for so many years in infectious diseases, so you gained major experience in that field, you might be asked to join the team and come up with a guideline. The program, the antimicrobial stewardship program, helps other physicians in the hospital choose the most appropriate antibiotic for different infections. Rather than guessing and starting random antibiotics on patients. So basically, it optimizes antibiotic use within the hospital and reduces extra unnecessary costs when you use expensive antibiotics that are not necessary. An example about that is starting an antibiotic, a broad spectrum antibiotic like meropenem, for example. It's a carbapenem, on a patient who comes into the hospital with a urinary tract infection. The patient looked sepsis, the patient looked septic, for example, and the physician, as soon as they saw the patient, oh, he's got sepsis, we're gonna start meropenem right away. However, looking at the guidelines, looking at the patient history, did they have any recent infection or not, and all that stuff, analyzing it, you might be able to go with a different antibiotic, such as ceftriaxone, for example, which is much cheaper, easier to use, and less broad spectrum than meropenem. That's just one example. Another example is when you get a patient admitted for cellulitis, and you the physician immediately starts vancomycin on that patient. I mean, most of the time we do MRSA screens when the patient comes into the hospital if we are worried about MRSA, especially in a case like cellulitis if there's a wound or something. But even if there's no wounds, we can still do the MRSA screen. There are two types of screens, the NAERS screen from the nose and the Groen screen. And then if it's positive, there's a higher, maybe there's a chance the patient has MRSA, but it could be a colonization too. But if it's negative, we know for sure that this patient probably doesn't have an MRSA infection. So starting vancomycin right away on every single patient who has cellulitis can cause an overuse of vancomycin in a hospital. But if you follow the guidelines, if you follow the antimicrobial stewardship guideline, it might tell you that you should start with a different antibiotic, unless you're 100% sure that this is an MRSA. So yes, these guidelines are usually put together by a team of doctors, pharmacists, nurses sometimes, and other healthcare professionals if required. Now let's move to point number five. The next point, participates in ward rounds, program team meetings, and provision of pharmacy services at the unit level to enhance patient care. As a clinical pharmacist, you are required to be present in medical rounds on a daily basis. There are so many questions that come up in rounds that you need, or they need a pharmacist to answer. And sometimes when we do quick reviews of patients' medications in rounds, you can catch mistakes that could be corrected immediately in within the round, because the rounds consist of a pharmacist, yes, but also a doctor and a team of nurses, dietitians, physiotherapists, and many other healthcare professionals, sometimes students as well. So yes, your presence in rounds is very important and always sought. But sometimes you may not find time to attend rounds if you're covering more than one unit, because every unit has its own rounds. It's not one round for the whole hospital. No, you'll see rounds on ICU and a different rounds on CCU and different rounds on medical units with different doctors, of course, on every unit. So if you're covering all these units, you may not be able to attend all rounds, but if you can make it to any of them, that would be great, because they always need a pharmacist in rounds. It's also a quick way to get updates on patients' clinical status for yourself, to know the effects of medications, for example, that you've recommended, or to answer any medication-related questions, for sure. Ward rounds, like I said before, could happen in two different ways. Rounding with a physician and nursing team, which is the most common type of rounds, and it's usually happens in specialty areas like internal medicine, intensive care units, cardiac care units, and specialty areas. However, you might see different types of rounds where you round with nurses and other healthcare professionals, but no doctors. And this usually happens in an acute care medical setting where there are too many doctors covering too many patients. So every doctor basically admits one or two of their patients if they're really sick, and they come from the community to check on those patients. So you'll see so many doctors coming at random times to see their patients and order medications. So you cannot round, it's not possible to round with all of these doctors because they come at random times, okay? But there is always one fixed round in every day, on every day, where you round with the patient care coordinator and a team of nurses and other healthcare professionals, and we talk about the patient and see what orders came from the doctor that day. And always, if there is a question to the doctor, we can always contact them or leave them our plan in the chart and they'll see it later. But yes, there are different types of rounds. I hope this makes it clearer on how we round on patients. The next point in duties and responsibilities of a clinical pharmacist is that you are supposed to act as a department source or a department resource, I should say, in the assigned area of responsibility. Support both department and hospital staff by providing detailed drug information on issues related to drug therapy in those disease states which are treated within the program. Okay, as a clinical pharmacist, you will receive drug information questions almost on a daily basis. Okay, you should expect that. That should be your expectation. These questions could come from the pharmacy staff, or they could come from nurses or doctors or other healthcare professionals. Now, you're not expected to give an answer right away, but most of the time, the person asking you needs some directions as soon as possible. As a matter of fact, you should never answer a question off the top of your head unless you're 100% sure it's the correct answer. You should check my other video on how to answer a drug information question, because it's actually a systematic approach, and ASHP have done so much work on that to come up with a way to answer a drug information question, which you will see me talking about in another video. So check out the other video. It will teach you how to answer a drug information question. So basically, if you get a question and you're not 100% sure, tell the person who asked you, let me look at my resources and I'll get back to you with an answer. Let me review the patient and I'll get back to you with an answer. But do not answer off the top of your head. If someone approaches you and asks, hey, what's a good drug is ramipril a good drug for this patient to lower her blood pressure? If you say yes, ramipril is a first line drug for hypertension, that's a wrong answer, because you don't know the patient. She might be pregnant. How do you know? So that would make ramipril a contraindicated drug in this patient, actually. Okay, so do not answer off the top of your head unless you review the patient, you look at the chart, you look at the previous medications history, all the past medical history. Why is the patient at the hospital right now? Does she have any other medical conditions? And now you look at the guidelines for blood pressure management and see if she has previous medical conditions. Which of these medications would be the best? Is it ramipril? Is it diltiazem? Is it amlodipine? Whatever. Just review the patient before giving an answer. All right, moving on to the next point, point number 7, which I think would be our last point for today, contributes items such as case studies and review articles to professional journals by performing activities such as identifying topics, gathering and analyzing data, reviewing current literature, and writing and submitting articles for publication. Now, this point is not mandatory. As a clinical pharmacist, you're not going to be asked to publish professional articles in peer-reviewed journals. It's more of an academic job, but many clinical pharmacists choose to do that because it's a way to get promoted to a higher position when you publish a lot. Some places might ask you or tell you that you have to publish every year, mostly academic places. If you're working as a clinical pharmacist, but also you're an associate professor, for example, for a university, the university might ask you that you have, if you want to maintain your position, you have to publish on a yearly basis, and there is a number of publications that you have to publish. But overall, this does help you advance your career. A clinical pharmacist who practices in a specialty area and publishes a lot might qualify for something called the clinical pharmacy specialist position, and that's a kind of a promotion if you want to get promoted in the future. However, yes, I do publish. A lot of other clinical pharmacists do not publish any articles, and they're good. They're not gonna lose their jobs, so it's not really mandatory. I have another video on how to publish a review article if you're interested in doing that in the future. I have a step-by-step tutorial on how to write a professional article, medical article that you can submit to a professional peer-reviewed journal and get accepted for publication. Because if you do a random article that is not really standardized, you might, like, the chances are you're gonna get rejected. So you don't want that. A rejection is always a horrible thing. So even though you can take it and apply it to another journal, but still it might get rejected if it's not based on, if it's not standardized and based on the guidelines of writing an article. So check out my other video about writing a professional article. And I think this concludes the basic duties and responsibilities for a clinical pharmacist. Now, in the next few videos, I'm going to show you each and every one of them and what do we do to take it to the next level and be it actually and do it actually as we're supposed to, or even do it better than other clinical pharmacists. And I'll explain each one of them with examples, and there are also some cases that you can go through in the other videos that will help you practice. But before you start practicing, I would encourage you to look at the videos talking about each and every one of the duties and responsibilities and how to do it professionally, and then start practicing those. Once you master the duties and responsibilities of a clinical pharmacist, you can start practicing on actual patient cases to see how good you are now after learning all these different duties and responsibilities. Let me know in the comments if you have any questions. I love the questions that I keep getting from my viewers. And if you want me to publish a video about a specific topic, also let me know in the comments. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel and give me a like if you like the content that you watched today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.